this structure that he draws here at the end is a visual representation of how when a certain structure is created at the top of it through these levels of organization, consciousness would form because of it. That then you could take away the underlying structure that formed it, and then this would continue to exist independently. If it's right, it means you could create an artificial intelligence, which was in and of itself, could become conscious. Humans might someday be able to, without using biology, but using purely materialistic approaches, build a sufficiently complex machine that creates an object with consciousness and a soul. That's fascinating.
Haim was one of the first, if not the first, to posit that all interactions, gravity, EM, weak, and strong, are unified in a higher dimensional Euclidean space with extra so-called imaginary dimensions. This was prior even to Yang Mills. Apparently, Hermann Weyl said that the highest chance of anti-gravity lay with Haim's theories, but unfortunately, after several attempts, I wasn't able to track down this source. If someone viewing this has the source of the text on screen, then please let me know and place it in the comments. While it wasn't said publicly, it was known through the grapevine that the Glenn Martin Company was interested in anti-gravity. Recall, you can think of the Glenn Martin Company as the predecessor to Lockheed Martin. In Witten's words, there was a new thing in the wind at the time, which was anti-gravity. It was in the wind. I quickly learned that I should talk about gravity and that they would ask me about anti-gravity. And I'd say, well, we just learned about gravity. If there's anything to anti-gravity, it'll come along. MIT professor of the history of science, David Kaiser, along with University of Sydney professor of philosophy and physics, Dean Rickles, cataloged this, and the links are in the description, as well as links to all sources. Now, if this wasn't convoluted enough, Witten explicitly commented on potential anti-gravity materials, saying a guy in France was discovering that on the night of a new moon, a pendulum swung faster or slow. A guy named Townsend discovered that there was a type of bismuth that was repelled instead of attracting.
The first astrophysics symposium not only started this field of relativistic astrophysics, but it ended a chapter, which is a sort of interesting small chapter in the history of relativity. I'm referring to the worldwide craze that lasted for about 10 years in the discovery of anti-gravity. And I bring that in because that impacted on my life quite considerably. In the middle 1950s, I found myself after a different youth than one might expect, employed by the Martin Company, now the Lockheed Martin Company, which was mentioned by the dean earlier. In the mid-1950s then, I found myself employed at the Martin Company with a rather weak PhD, I would say, at the age of about 35, with a few children. There was a vice president of ideas. That was not his title, but his function was to bring the company into new eras. The company was building airplanes and building rockets. It ultimately built the Titan rocket, which was used for many space vehicle flights. The vice president had the idea, which was to him a wonderful idea, to develop anti-gravity. Of course, when he tried the idea in public, you can imagine the greeting he received by the scientists.
Let's sum up so far in 5 points. Number one, in 1915, Einstein publishes General Relativity. Number two, since around the 1920s, work in gravity stagnates. Number three, years later, from a personal interest in anti-gravity, Babson and Banson started privately funding research into gravity around the 1950s. Number four, the reputation of these two organizations, so the Gravity Research Foundation and the Institute for Field Physics, grew as the DeWitts and other physicists associated themselves with it, eventually even mavens like Penrose and Hawking. Number 5, private industry, like the primogenitors of Lockheed Martin, become involved with Babson by first being a donor, and then second, by creating an industry-oriented clone of his institute. The Institute for Field Physics held a monumental conference known as the Chapel Hill Conference in 1957. To explain why this was a huge deal in the history of gravity research, you have to know that if you look through the history of physics conferences, you'll find that after Einstein published General Relativity, which, recall, was in 1915, that there was a distinct lack of gravity-related conferences. Sure, there was the 1927 Solvay Conference, but that was primarily regarding quantum mechanics. Thus, the Chapel Hill Conference, organized by Agnew Bahnsen, was the gravity conference to rival that of the Solvay conference. It was here that the gravity community came together and shaped the future of the field. For many researchers, it was their first opportunity to interact with like-minded individuals who shared a passion for exploring the mysteries of gravity. For instance, this is where Witten and Feynman first met. The role of gravitation in physics was a report commissioned by the Gravity Research Foundation. This report was a comprehensive survey of the state of gravitational physics, highlighting the latest discoveries, ongoing challenges, and potential future directions. It took me quite some time to find, but I managed to get a digital reprint. The report still reads well to this day, even though it was published well over half a century ago. As the 1960s approached, the relativity renaissance that Roger Babson and Agnew Bahnsen helped instigate was in full swing. Agnew's institute sponsored Peter Higgs while he was working on his now famous Higgs boson research. John Wheeler made critical contributions to black hole thermodynamics and the notion of quantum foam, the latter suggesting that space-time at the smallest scales is subject to quantum fluctuations, a step toward bridging quantum mechanics and general relativity that some still take today. In the 1960s and 70s, Stephen Hawking developed a series of significant results that broadened the horizons of theoretical physics. Notably, this stretch predates his more recognized work, such as the popular book, A Brief History of Time. Many of Hawking's ideas were disseminated first in essay form through this contest sponsored by the Gravity Research Foundation, prior to appearing in full article form. Some even prior to the famous Penrose-Hawking singularity theorems, though Penrose published his first result in 1965. So think about what this means. Hawking was popularized in part because of Babson's funding. We don't know the degree to which those nascent ideas in Hawking's head were catalyzed into a rigorous form because he was allowed to be more speculative due to this contest. The same with other results. That is to say, without Babson and Bahnsen, who knows if we'd have the results of gravitational waves by Bondi and others in 1957, or 1958 with the ADM formalism, or 1960 with the gravitational wave detector being built, which was eventually improved and refined, leading to the creation of LIGO, or 1961, Regi calculus, which is a discrete approximation to general relativity that replaces the continuous space-time with a simplicial complex. Or 1962, the Bondi-Sachs formalism, which analyzes the asymptotic structure of space-time at null infinity, allowing for the study of gravitational radiation and energy loss in general relativity. Or 1963, the famous Kerr solution. Or the singularity theorem of 1965, along with the Ray-Chowdhury equation. Or later on, with computational methods of numerical relativity and black hole mechanics in 1971 with Brandon Carter, and 1973 with the Hawking entropy with Bekenstein, or 1974 with Hawking radiation. That is, Hawking predicted that black holes should radiate as if they were black bodies at a certain temperature. This theoretical prediction provides a link between general relativity, quantum mechanics, and thermodynamics. During the post-Cold War period, the study of gravity underwent a tremendous shift, with theorists increasingly favoring string theoretic approaches as not only a potential solution to a particular physics problem, but instead string theory was seen as the solution to the primary physics problem called quantum gravity. Notice the shift. Agnew Bahnsen's life was intrinsically tied to his quest to understand gravity. But in a mirthless, merciless jest of destiny, the very force he sought to understand would play a part in his untimely demise. Bahnsen died from a plane crash and burned at Worcester Airport. Bahnsen, a man who dedicated his existence to dissecting and directing gravity, was ironically vanquished by the very force he dared to defy. This lineage was instrumental in spawning a community of researchers, including notable figures such as Roger Penrose, Roy Kerr, Jürgen Ehlers, and the others listed on screen. Their research into gravity has unmistakably deepened our understanding of the universe, a testament to the enduring impact of Babson and Bahnsen. As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality-spiraling concepts, from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/TOE, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.